meeting so that we can actually post it later. And we'll go from there. Everything going good so far, Amanda? Okay. Let me just see if I can get us down to the next page here. So to just give you a little bit more information about Bird Studies Canada, many of you know the program, some of you don't. Bird Studies Canada is a not-for-profit, and what we do is we work with scientists and partnerships and citizen scientists to conduct science monitoring and ground-based conservation and advocacy based on science. It is something we've done for many years, and the Marsh Monitoring Program is one of our bigger programs. It occurs in 4 different regions of Canada. One of those regions is the Great Lakes, so it also occurs in the U.S. And it has been ongoing since the start of the Great Lakes Marsh Monitoring Program in 1995. So just a quick question. Amanda is going to track this for all you guys who are listening in. Can you just let us know using the chat box if you've been involved with any other citizen science programs at all? We'll give you about 30 seconds for just this. Just say yes or no, and when we do our question and answer session later, Amanda is going to tell us what the results of that are. So go ahead and post what you think about that, and we'll go from there. That's probably a good 30 seconds, so we'll move on now. So basically, I asked all you guys what you wanted in a webinar, and I got some great responses, and I openly invited just the people who responded in the poll to the webinar, so hopefully we're representing the right group here. And what I heard was that most of you wanted a refresher, you didn't need full orientation information, that what you wanted was birds and amphibian technique, but you wanted them separated. Less than a third of you wanted a refresher on habitat. I'm sort of giving into that. You did not want to discuss route establishment in this particular webinar. It was very good to see that over half of the people who responded felt the data analysis was reported well and explained well in the reports and newsletters. So at this point, I'm not certain we need a future presentation by Doug Tozer, but if he has some interesting science coming out on this program in the summer, we may change our mind about that and plan one after the newsletter goes out. That right now is a bit undecided. So the outline for tonight's webinar will be, we're going to go over route and station layout just a tiny bit so that I think you need it to understand how to survey right. We're going to review our frogs and toads. We're going to go over how to monitor amphibians and some troubleshooting tips for when you're doing your amphibian survey. Now, there's people on here who have been surveying as long as I have. So if you have advice or questions because you've been at this for a long time, put it in the chat box so that we can bring that up to everybody involved. We're going to go over how to fill out the amphibian data forms and troubleshooting with that. We're going to go over a bit about staying safe. Then we're going to have a bit of fun and try a mock survey. We're also going to have a couple question and answer sessions. And then if time is allowed, I have a sneaky suspicion this is going to run long, but if we have enough time, if people want to stick around and learn about completing habitat descriptions or have me show some of the data that slides that Doug has put together, I'd happily do so later. So I didn't realize that call was in there. That's a good start to the show. We're going to just go over some station layout, amphibian surveys, and safety, as I mentioned. So I'm not putting a lot of effort into this because most of you have been in the wetlands enough to know what you're doing. But I just wanted to reiterate that when you go to your stations every year, you need to sit down and sometimes take a critically look and say, is this still a marsh? Is it still a safe marsh? So keep things like the kind of plants, the visibility, the safety, the noise, ease of access, all these things in mind when you're surveying, because wetlands do change. We have a lot of water changes. We have a lot of natural change in the vegetation at wetlands. Now, to give you a bit more information on stations, because I think it relates well to everything, bird stations when you're surveying, they need to be 250 meters apart. Amphibian stations need to be 500 meters apart or back to back. The reason why we choose these distances is because we believe to prevent overlap, you can hear readily up to 500 meters, if not further. And for birds, you can broadcast up to 250 meters. Now, we say our sampling area is 100 meter semicircle. Or the latest discussion that Doug and I had is, think about it like a baseball diamond and you're at home plate. And your whole survey station goes out to the back of the outfield. Now, that is true, but again, that's as much important for habitat descriptions for anything else. When we're doing the amphibian surveys, everything counts that you hear as long as it's not behind you. So again, route layout, these are the two classic models, all down one side of a larger wetland, or a single or maybe a couple stations in smaller wetlands, and you do several of them. Route one, typically every other station is surveyed for amphibians. Route two, you often can survey every station depending on how far apart each little wetland is, but sometimes, like in the example of D&E, you may only be able to survey one, or if these wetlands are as close together as this particular image suggests, maybe you can only survey two for amphibians because you have to have that 500 meter distance. So let's take another question. I'm very curious. I heard amphibians at my house last couple nights, not tonight. So just a quick poll for everybody out there to put in the chat box. Have you heard any amphibians yet? I have heard the odd bit about spring peepers calling. I had wonderful full choruses of western chorus frogs in my backyard. I'm just lucky that way that I get to hear them every spring. And the snow's all gone here, Terry. So it's just one of those situations. I'm very curious. I was under the impression in Ohio they probably would have been calling several days now. And I know we've had Michigan surveyors who started a couple days early because of the calling in Michigan. Okay. Now, I think we'll just give that a few more seconds, and we'll continue from there. Okay, let's move on off. So, basic concept for when we survey frogs. As you all know, it's three visits a year, and those are based on the three classic breeding periods for different frog species. You want to try to keep them about 15 days apart. So we ballpark it, you're going to survey somewhere in between early April to mid-June most years. The timing is very dependent on temperature. You always begin about half an hour after sunset to midnight. You want to survey when there's little or no wind or little or no precipitation, and it's a 3-minute survey. Now, I mentioned surveys versus days. I'm assuming you have read the protocol. Of course you have read the protocol. And in the protocol, it lists specific survey visit windows for each reason, the south, the central, and the north. And as you move up, those windows are later in the season. What happens is when you have an early spring like this one, the amphibians call early, especially those early spring breeders like chorus frog and spring peeper and wood frog, and they're hard to catch. So you often have to keep in mind that you may have to survey early. A lot of people in our area were hearing them, so that would have been smart to survey them Sunday night would have been perfect for surveying the early amphibians in our area. So you're really looking for your first survey greater than 5 degrees, even if it happens before April 1st or April 15th or May 1st. And you want to have a moist environment. Often right after the second warm spring rain is perfect. And then for your second survey window, you want it greater than 10 degrees. This one here. Or 50 degrees Fahrenheit, because again, that suits when you're starting to get your full choruses of your mid-season breeders. And then for your final survey, you're talking your late-season breeders, your deep-water amphibians, and they need warmer water temperatures. So you have to wait till it warms up even further to 17 degrees Celsius, about 63 degrees Fahrenheit. With that said, we all have busy lives, and they're getting busier through time. So what I recommend is just keep your go bag ready, and when it's time to survey, the first night that fits into your schedule, that matches the condition, grab the go bag and go and survey. That's the easiest way to deal with it. Sometimes that doesn't work, and you can only get a survey on a specific night or a specific number of nights, but try your best to fit it into your schedule so that you're hitting the best temperatures. Now, to survey amphibians, we use what is called the calling code index. And this is based on male territorial behavior during breeding. So all the males trying to differentiate themselves from each other and to tell the females, I'm the best one out here. So as more and more males enter that particular wetland, the calls increase, the sound increases, the overlap increases. And that's what we use to base the chorus calling code on. So the first code is a code 1. And when you have a code 1, you have no call overlap. You can hear each individual of that species calling, and you can count each individual. Now a code 2, there's some call overlap. It's getting a little difficult to figure out which frog is which, but you can still estimate the count. Code 3 is a blur of sound. It's so much overlap in the calls of all the amphibians in that wetland, it's just a wall of noise. And there's absolutely no chance of being able to identify which individual is, and there's no chance of counting them. Now, I wanted to ask you guys this, because this is important to know where you guys are having problems with amphibian ID, so we can perhaps try to address them. And if I can't address them tonight, I will come up with an answer and put it in the newsletter. So what frog species do you find difficult to ID and why? And you can just plunk this in the chat box and we'll keep track of it. Or is there a couple of frogs that you find are quite similar, especially certain times of the season, and you're noticing that? Now, if you find they're all easy to ID, that's great. But just in case you guys don't know for sure. Now, let's go a little bit, Carolyn. You'll really like this. We're about to go over our frog species. And we'll go over a little bit about the calls and see how to identify each one of them. We're going to do this by breeding order somewhat. We're doing the wood frog first because it's got the shortest breeding season. Chorus frog often starts before wood frog, but it has a slightly longer breeding season. So the first three species, wood frog, chorus frog, and spring peeper, are all vernal pool species. They like shallow water. They start very early in the season, and they want to breed, lay the eggs, and have the eggs hatch before those shallow wetlands dry up. The wood frog is really fun. It sounds like a duck quacking. Now, chorus frog, as I said, we have them right now breeding in my area. Some people have them in their area, some people don't. And this, oh, just a second.
You can't hear the frog call.
So you guys can't hear the frog calls. That takes a lot of the fun out of it. Let me see what I can turn up here. Well, I guess we're going to go without frog calls because I can't figure out how to put them on unless I do them through another mechanism. Let me just try something here. I do. I'm going to try that.
It's something from MMP. But why am I not hearing it?
Can you guys hear that one?
We've got something plugged in.
Still couldn't hear it? Well, it looks like we're going without calls tonight. That'll be a technical difficulty that we'll have to figure out for next time. So my apologies for that, everyone. So I'll just have to describe the calls. For the chorus frog, by the way, all these calls are in your CD, your training CD. They're also available on the secure website, which I'll discuss later. So you can readily pick them up from elsewhere. So the next one, the chorus frog, it sounds like you're running a thumb across a comb. Then we have the spring peeper, which is a single peep that is heard about 1 second, and they get very loud, and they have a fairly long breeding season, so you can hear them quite a long period of time throughout the season. What you will find with this particular species is that they also have another call that is kind of a trill, kind of like a chorus frog, but it's got that high pitch to it, while the chorus frog is much more of a lower pitch, and it's got a different rhythm to it. It's got a bit more of an ascending trill. It gets a little quicker as it goes, while the chorus frog trill always holds the same rhythm. And that is also in the CD if you want to listen to that. Now we're going to move into the mid-season breeders, and the first one is the northern leopard frog. The northern leopard frog is a quite common frog. You often see it in your lawn. And this is a really little guy in the picture here. And their call is a long snore followed by a chuckle. And the chuckle is very much like rubbing wet hands on a balloon. And that's common that you hear with this species. What you have to watch with this one is sometimes in cooler weather, you might, like at the beginning of its breeding season, it might be truncated. It may not play the chuckle, may not say the chuckle, or it may just do the chuckle on the end. Our next one is the American toad, and this is your classic garden toad. And it is they call it non-musical trill. I find it sounds like a metallic bug to me, but that's my personal opinion of it. And this particular species, it's got a very long call, 30 seconds long. That's something to keep in mind when you do your calling code. Like, it's not unrealistic to have a code 2 with calls overlapping of American toad, but only have 3 toads. Well, something like a gray tree frog is, you could probably have a code 1 up to a 10. Just because the length of the call of the American toad is so long, it gets more difficult to identify each individual sooner. Now we're starting to get a little later. This is a gray tree frog. It's the only frog that we have in Ontario that changes color. This guy has got a very bird-like trill. Like a woodpecker, and again, look it up in the guide and in the CD-ROM. That's a great place to play it, and it's just a fantastic loud frog, and you'll hear it when it starts to warm up about the same time, quite frankly, you want to open your windows at night is when these guys start calling. Now, are you hearing a gray tree frog, or are you hearing a bird at night? Because there's always a chance, right? Gray tree frogs move less than the trees. So sometimes simple thought processes when you're trying to ID your species help a lot. Now we're getting into our deep water frogs, the green frog and the bullfrog. Both these species overwinter as tadpoles. Because of that, they need deeper ponds, and the temperature in those big ponds and big lake areas have to warm up before they start breeding. The green frog, well, my kids call it the banjo frog because it sounds like the plucking of a banjo string. And then we have the bullfrog, which is the biggest frog in Ontario and in the Great Lakes Basin. And it sounds like it's very deep, it's very rhythmic, and it's very bass in the call. Now, I personally, one of my challenges every year is I love the bullfrog. I was raised right on a bullfrog wetland, and I would fall asleep to the code 3 of a bullfrog. And so every spring, the first time I hear a green frog, I think, oh, it is a bullfrog. And then I listen, and I realize, no, it's not as rhythmic. It's not quite right. But it's just one of those things that catches me every year, and I have to sit down and think about it and identify this carefully. So we have some rarer species, and I'm not going to go over these in detail. I just want to make a note that some of you will see them or hear them. Many of you won't. Mink frog is got a very unique region. Pickerel frog tends to like cold water streams. I don't think you're as likely to see them in a large wetland. Fowler's toad is found on sandy shorelines of Lake Erie and the bottom of Lake Michigan. Blanchard's cricket frog, you're going to have to be in our far southern areas to see them at all, and then it's still very rare. You're definitely not going to see them in Ontario. So those are ones that you should not, you are less likely to see, and you have to be extra careful with that, with the identification. Pickerel frog, I personally have never heard. But when I listen to the call, it reminds me somewhat of the northern leopard frog, except it's shorter, almost, and quicker. So that's something to keep in mind if you think you have pickerel frogs in your area. Okay, a quick question for you. What is your favorite frog? We'll give you about a minute to answer that, and we'll go on from there. I don't think, well, I guess I just said my favorite frog is the bullfrog. That was the one I was raised with. I personally really like the chorus frog right now because they're at my home. And later on in the season, we're actually coming up to the house. So we get to enjoy those with my kids when they were kids. They're all almost adults now, so it's no longer an option for us. But it was something we've always enjoyed, was going out looking for the chorus frogs when they're at the point where they start moving around. So what are some common things that go wrong when you survey amphibians? I still find today, it's becoming less often probably because I tell everybody not to do it, but a lot of people try to wait for the perfect night. Oh, the winds are a little too high. Oh, the temperature's just not right. Ooh, I think it can be better conditions for this. I'm sure they're going to be calling more tomorrow night. Don't. If you try to get the right night, it will never happen. If you're sitting there, everything looks appropriate, and it's the start of the spring season, and they're going to start to call, get out there and survey, as long as it fits into your schedule. I personally take advantage of a wetland that's close to home, my home, and I listen, and when I hear them calling there, I know it's a good night to survey. So that's one way of doing it, and that's also a great reference if you're in an urban area wetland and you're afraid you're not hearing enough amphibians. If you go to another wetland on the way there and you listen and you hear amphibians, you know the conditions are right. So you just may have a wetland that has fewer frogs in it. The next one is surveying after the breeding is done, and this relates right back to waiting for the perfect night. If they have a good, quick breeding season, you may miss them quite readily. So again, trust the temperature and the conditions and get out there as soon as you can. An interesting report I wanted to mention to you, Doug Tozer wrote a watershed report last year. It's on the website. It's called, we have it listed under the link, Watershed Report. And it's got a little bit of data in there about some late recent studies on climate change and frog calling in the Great Lakes. So if you're interested in that, look it up and see what's happening. And it probably also references the actual scientific publication, and you can look at that as well. The next most common thing is inappropriate weather conditions. Too dry, too wet, or too windy. I find this happens often when you're surveying far from home, because it's difficult to know what the conditions are like there. That's why you'll find I often say, don't take this marsh, it's an hour away. Take this marsh, it's 5 minutes away. When you're close to home, you're in the same microclimate, you have a better way of telling if this is a good time to survey. If you have one of those marshes that are an hour away, find a website that gives you good information, including wind speeds, and use that before you go and check the conditions. And see what their forecasted conditions are for an hour or 2 hours later, so you have a better idea what's going on and whether it's worth your while to go. Minor thing, but I do hear it every time somebody sets up a route in a little gap area. I want to survey this location because it has a lot of frogs. I don't feel this is the location that should be surveyed because it doesn't have enough frogs. Remember that our goal here is to monitor changes in frogs, not so we want to have a representative of all the wetlands out there, just not the highly active ones. A funny one that I get asked a lot is people want their data so they can look at it before they go survey. I'm not inclined to send it to them, as some people know already. That's because I don't want them biased. I don't want them to see their data or maybe the previous surveyor's data and think this is all I'm going to see. I want them to go out there with fresh ears every year and record what they're hearing. The same with the habitat. I want you to go out there with fresh eyes every year and record the habitat you see this year without looking at the past sheets. It's a funny one, and I don't think it's a big deal, but don't talk a lot while you're surveying. I go out there and I don't say anything. But the problem is every time you talk, you are at risk of decreasing the calling, especially close to you. And you are also at the risk of missing calls. So that's something that you should try to avoid. Now, if you have other errors or other problems that you have made or you have seen others make, feel free to share them via the chat or Twitter or Facebook and let us know, and we can bring these up and share them with others as well. And this brings me to the item that I contact people the most, misidentifying species. We're in a situation with the data, the quality of the data we collect, that our data trickles into atlases on both sides of the Great Lakes Basin. We're often share it with research scientists and with Natural Heritage Information Center and many people. So it's important that we do our best to make sure the information is as accurate as possible. Now, you guys could be hearing coarse frogs out of season or a pickerel frog in a rare place. I'm not going to sit there and say you aren't, but just remember what the calls are in your area, what you should be seeing in your area, and always keep that in your mind. And if you think you're hearing an unusual call, listen to it carefully, check it again. Just be certain it's there before you report it to me. Then when you get the little email saying, huh, you heard such and such a frog and you're way outside of its range, what do you think? Did this really happen? You can say, yes, I'm sure I heard it. It sounded this far different from something else, and I'm absolutely certain it was that species. A couple ones that I know are easy to misidentify is the spring peeper territorial call, which is that trill I was telling you about, that sounds a bit like a chorus frog, but it's higher pitched and it goes up a little bit quicker, or versus chorus frog. Especially in a marsh that does not have a lot of amphibians in it, it's very easy to mis-ID that spring peeper call. I also wonder how easy it is to misidentify northern leopard frog from pickerel frog, just because to me the calls are very similar. I have never been in a wetland with a pickerel frog calling, so I can't be sure, but I would think it's like a shortened northern leopard frog call without the chuckle. As I mentioned before, what frogs do you find difficult to ID and why? You can put those in the chat if you haven't already, and Amanda's going to give me a list, I believe, of ones we should discuss. So, Amanda, can you... do you want to unmute yourself, or do I need to? We're going to have Amanda tell us.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. So I'm going to just go over the questions that we asked so far. So where is everyone based? We've got a few people from, two people from Wisconsin, two people all the way down in Florida, three people from New York, four from Ohio, and then the rest, so 29 from Ontario, so a lot from Ontario, all over Ontario though. And then how many people do citizen science, other citizen science projects? 30 people said yes, so that's really great. And then 15 people said no, they haven't had a chance to. Have people heard amphibians yet? So most people said no, 32 people said no, and 14 people said yes. I'm guessing the more southern people. Let's see. There was only a few people who answered the difficult calls. Some said tree frogs that are hard to distinguish from each other. Telling leopard frogs and pickerel frogs apart, and spring peepers. And then the favorite frog, so it's kind of all over the board. Howlers, chorus frogs, bullfrogs all have one. Green frogs have two people, wood frogs have two. Leopard frogs and American toads have five. Peepers, nine. And the clear winner, tree frog, with 17 votes, but the unique vote goes to Kermit the frog, which was someone's favorite. So thanks for being honest, that's great. All right, okay, so that's for all the polls. Kathy, do you have anything to say there for the polls?
No, the polls are great. I will go over a couple things. Tree frogs, I'm assuming you mean identifying individuals because they're overlapping, or do you mean the three different spring tree frogs, like spring peepers, chorus frogs, and wood frogs? Do you understand the question? Well, the first one, for overlapping tree frog calls, that can be tough. Now, remember that if you think there, you can't identify the exact number of the calling, you've got to code two. You might think you only have three calls from three different frogs, but because you can't be certain, it's still code two. Wood frogs, chorus frogs, and spring peepers, if that's a problem. The wood frog's pretty unique. It does quack. There's no doubt it's a quack. The only thing I think might be even close to sounding like it is a mink frog. And again, that's a rare enough species. I shouldn't say rare. That's a regionally specific species. So I myself haven't heard it yet either. So that is a problem with that. Again, with the spring peeper and the chorus frog, you just have to keep listening in on that. I do find myself in my backyard when I get a full chorus of spring peepers and a full chorus of chorus frogs, it's very difficult to tell. And when the chorus frog species quiet down and the spring peepers get louder, again, it's a little bit more difficult to notice a transition. So it's the same. We all have to be aware of what we have problems with and try to accommodate them and be careful when we do it. That's the best guess that I can give for that. I like Kermit too, by the way. Do we have any specific questions that we need to broach, Amanda?
Yeah, we definitely have a few questions. So I'll just go through it in the order that they were asked. So is there a certain number of days in a row above 5 degrees that people should wait before doing their first survey?
That's a good question, and I don't have a good answer for that. They get breeding so quick at times. I usually work at about the second warm night. That certainly was the case in my yard, but that's just my yard, right? But I think often it's that second warm night, especially for the vernal pool breeders, those early ones, they're ready to call. You'll have a little bit more time with the mid-season breeders. I say that, but I myself find lately in my area, they do breed early, and then they'll get cut off by a cold spell. Because we'll often get like really warm temperatures in mid-April and off the going, and they're breeding about 2 weeks after my early season breeders. So I would just keep an ear out and listen and see what you can find out. And if you have a friend close to your wetland that you survey, call them a lot. Message them and ask them if they're hearing anything. That might help as well. Any other questions?
Yep, definitely a few more. So kind of along the same lines, is it okay to do a survey when the temperature before midnight is above 5 but will go lower later?
Oh yeah, the frogs don't care what the temperature is later.
Perfect. Kind of along the same lines as well, what is the impact of water depth in each area that are close to each other?
Well, that certainly helps decide which frogs are in that area and where the frogs are positioned. A classic example, a lot of us know that if we do the big wetlands, is you only get your early breeders on the perimeter. And you don't get near as many in the center. They'll be in the center, but you get the full choruses on the perimeter. And I see that with a lot of our wetland data that comes in. Certainly, if you're close to the Great Lakes, for example, down here where Amanda's starting this year, and she's surveying off Lake Erie, so her amphibian calling probably will start late in the mine because of the temperature differences at her Great Lakes wetland versus my inland wetland. You also definitely see the species because you'll get your green frogs and your northern leopard frogs and your American toads at a mid-depth marsh, while you need the bigger, deeper marshes for your green frogs and your bullfrogs. So hopefully in a roundabout way I've answered that question. You're still going to have your wood frogs calling early when the temperatures are right, even if it's a deep water marsh. They just might not be located in the deep water because they do not want to be where the predatorial frogs are and the fish.
Okay, and then just to clarify, should temperature take priority over date or time between surveys?
Both. Ideally, you want to keep the 15 days, but if you're starting to hear your second breeders and you're only at 12 days, go for it and survey them. I think right now the way climate variation is going on, we pretty much have to work a little harder to meet the right periods, and we may never not meet them. We already know we have a hard time meeting wood frog timing. It's just too difficult in most of our regions. So the dates are more of a guideline, while the temperature is the key field.
Great. Okay, now a few questions about CDs. Can you send out a CD of frog calls? Someone misplaced theirs from last year. And another question is there a CD that has single tracks for each frog so they don't have to listen to the whole CD to find one call?
Well, I'm hoping that's from a volunteer who's been with the program for a very long time, because our latest CD has a track for each call and has probably for 5 or 6 years. I remember getting them all switched over a few years back. So definitely, if you still have a CD that has a single track with all the calls on it, email me and I'll send you a new one. If you have lost your CD, email me. That's the easiest way to deal with it because I kind of triage everything and I get things out to you. Email me. I'll send you a new one. The other option is you can go onto the secure website, the Nature Counts website, and the MP3 files are on there for every track as well. Right now, they're not in the handiest of forms. I have to figure out how if I can put a zip file on Nature Counts and put a zip file of all the MP3 files for the training CD on there. Right now they're each separate. So if you want to listen to them that way, I would suggest going on to MP3 and just to Nature Counts and just listening to your frog calls there. But that's another option if you want to pull off MP3 files. You can do it there.
Okay. Someone else asked, can we download calls from the website to play back on a phone? And then a few people said that they have an app from Ontario Nature. Have you tried that, Kathy?
Have I tried the app? No, I don't think I have because I don't use a smartphone. Amanda will say I'm wrong about that. My daughter gave me her old smartphone to use about 6 months ago. So I have not tried the app. We need you to use So I would not advise using an app to identify frogs while you're doing a survey. You need to know them well enough to survey without that because you only have 3 minutes. But apps are cool to learn with, and I would certainly suggest that you, if the app goes on your phone and you can use it to help you get your ID better. Use it to help the Herp Atlas to track where these species are as well. So if you're out and you hear frogs, go run through the app and put the data off to them for that single casual species, because what they're collecting is presence absence, which is very different than what we're collecting. So both programs are equally important. Now, as for downloading the what was the other half of that question? Did I miss half that question? Nope. Okay. So hopefully that was helpful.
Okay, some more questions. So wood frogs are usually quite loud, but are they also quieter at times?
You know what? It depends so much on the number of frogs that are there. So if you only have a couple of wood frogs, they'll definitely be quiet. Temperature, most frogs are the loudest when they're at the ideal temperature for the breeding. So you're probably hearing best, maybe I would think about 8-9 degrees. You'll also find wood frogs are softer in many ways if there's low numbers, than both spring peepers and chorus frogs. So you get into a very challenging situation, and I can't make it easier for you, where you have these massive walls of sound, and you have to pick out the little spring peeper that's closer, the little chorus frog or wood frog that's close. And it's difficult to do, but it's basically one of the things that we have to try and do is just make sure we don't miss any species.
Perfect. So a few method questions. One minute. Am I muted? No.
Nope.
Sorry. So Dave asks, I survey a small pond directly in front of me of chorus, peepers, etc. Behind me are wood frogs and leopard frogs. The survey station will not include the latter. These will only be noted. It doesn't seem to be inclusive of other areas in the marsh. And then a similar comment, should we make note of species that we are seeing between survey stations? I have to walk a trail and often see some on the trail but don't hear them.
I call this Murphy's Law of Frog Surveys. You always hear more behind you and between stations. We are looking at population changes, so the whole point is to have a specific area. If you want to survey, know every species of the wetland, this is not the best choice for that. It's the best choice to have an idea how that wetland changes through time. If you do hear other species in between your stations, or behind you and you know they're not covered, feel free to put them on like the Herb Atlas. That's a great place to put those things. And they really appreciate the data. When I say the ones between your stations and the ones behind you, keep in mind that we also share our data with the Herb Atlas. So you don't have to send them your station count data. That will get to them. It's the stuff that you can't record on the forms that you can send to them. And I know I myself get frustrated when I hear, I've had Fowler's toads calling, which is a really cool species to hear, and they have been off my stations. And it's frustrating. I get that. But it's just the way the survey's set up.
So where can they report them, Kathy?
You can put them in the notes, but it's not data that's used. So if you want to ensure that data is used, as I said, there's a mechanism with the Herp Atlas, the Ontario Herp Atlas, and for example the Michigan Atlas, and most areas have something where you can send that information to them to be included. So the other thing to keep in mind as well, this brings up an interesting point. If you know you have one of those unusual species and you think it's a rarity, it's important perhaps to pass that forward to your provincial or state biologist and for your region versus just telling us, because we won't have that information processed until the fall. So if it's something that needs to be double checked or needs to be careful about, you need to take the step in passing it on to the person you think it needs to be given to.
Perfect. And then one quick question about weather websites. Any suggestions for good weather websites that are accurate?
Oh boy. No, I was using the Weather Network just because it's convenient and it tends to give hour by hour. So I've been relying on that. I like it just because I can put in almost any town and it finds it for me. I have tried at times the marine forecast because I was raised on Lake Erie, so I'm used to the marine forecast. I don't think it's any better. So I don't have a really good answer for you. I just use more because it's convenient than anything else. Are we all done? We got more. We're all done? So we'll move on to the next stage. I'm glad to be hearing all these questions. If we go over and you have to leave, don't worry about it. It looks like we're going to because we're getting a lot of questions. But I'm hoping that you're all finding this very handy. So the next part is going to be a quick look at forms, and I think you're going to find this handy. This is the route contact form that you hand in every year, and for most of you, you only have to fill out Section A. The only time you fill out Section B and C is if you change your survey stations, or I specifically ask you to fill out Section B and C. And that will happen when I sit there and say, whoa, I don't have good information on this site, so I need more information. Otherwise, you just worry about the very top bit, and that's it. And often I pre-fill that in for you and it arrives completed already. And that's the back side of that sheet. Next, we're going to look at the forms. So say you're in the field and you're doing an amphibian survey, and a few notes when you're filling out your forms, your data forms in the field. You want to record all the species you hear, regardless of the distance, as long as they're in front of you. But we need to know which species are within 100 meters so we can tie it to the habitat. That's the whole point of that. We're not counting species within 100 meters. We're just tying it back to habitat for habitat association work. You always include the code. You include the count for code 1 and 2. As I mentioned before, you do not record amphibians behind you. And be careful. There may be birds calling. And they, of course, move more. So that's the biggest thing to keep in mind with them. So you may hear something that is not an amphibian. I've had that happen to me when my very first survey season confused the heck out of me. So it does happen. So when you're filling out your form, you put the top information in, and then you continue on, and you give us your start time, your noise code for the background, and the direction you're facing. Your focal point direction should not change every year, but we put it down as a reference point. You're probably thinking now, how do I know what the background noise code is? On your amphibian forms, there's always a page of codes attached to the form, or half a page. So they're always there with you in the field so that you can quickly look them up. And as you can see on this form, we also give you the call level codes, so you have those right in front of you as well. So as you're surveying, you get to your station, you wait your minute for things to calm down, and you start surveying. And what you hear is, first off, some spring peepers. And there's some overlap, but you think there's six of them because it's a guess. So you put down code 2 with 6 calling. Next, you notice there's a code 3 of spring peepers way in the back to your right. So you put those down. You don't add a count because you just can't tell. There's too many of them. Listening a little more. Oh, and you also mark that they are both in the 100-meter area and outside. Now, that's an estimate. We recognize you're out there in the dark, and you can't be absolutely accurate when 100 meters in. So it's just a rough estimate what you hear. And then you go on and you hear very close to you chorus frogs, code 3s. That's a lot of chorus frogs. But because you're hearing these guys, it makes it difficult to hear the other ones. So now you have to start being very, very careful what else you're hearing. And because they're in, you mark them as in. You don't mark out because there's nothing out. You continue listening. You have a single lonely wood frog a little bit farther out on your left. And that's code 1, 1 calling. And you have another 8 or so, but you're not entirely certain because there is some overlap close to you on your right, and you mark those down, code 2, 8 calling. Finally, just near the end, you manage to catch on that there's some northern leopard frog. Oh, you mark those down in and out, your wood frogs. And then you also hear those northern leopard frogs calling in the distance. You think there's 7, there is overlap, so you think it's a code 2. And you mark those down as out because none of them are calling inside. So you do this for all your stations, and you go back to your desk or to your car, and you fill out your paperwork. Now, if anybody has heard me talk, you'll notice that I always say, do your paperwork as soon as you get back to the car. There's a method in my madness here. The longer you wait before you fill out the paperwork, the more work it is for you. It's fresh in your mind, you know the stuff, you can tell where you may have made small errors, and you only have one visit, versus if you wait till the end of the season, you're going to have 3 visits to do. If you do multiple marshes, you'll have a whole bunch of these forms to put out. And if you combine it with all those other citizen science programs you do, that's a lot of data to complete at the end of the survey season. So do it in the car before you go home. Take the minute to do it, and it will make your life a lot easier. So how do we fill out this form? Well, we start off at the top. We put the weather and the visit conditions in and the background noises. And then we go and we look at what we have. And I usually pick one species at the top or bottom and find all the counts for it. So here for wood frogs, we have 2 of them. We have 1 code 1, 1 frog calling, and a code 2, 8 frog callings. What you record is the highest code, which is 2, and you count up the number of frogs, which is 9. So let's move to the next species, which we're going to do northern leopard frogs. We have a code 2 with 1-7, with 7 callings. So we put that down. Now you'll notice if you look at the wood frog on the form versus the northern leopard frog, the little circle is filled in for the wood frogs and not for the northern leopard frogs. Because with wood frogs, we had calls inside the circle. Northern leopard frogs, we had them out and nothing inside. So we go on to the next species, which is spring peeper. We have two code 2 with 6 inside and a code 3 outside. So we put in the code 3 because it's the highest. We don't record any amphibians and the number of amphibians calling because we just can't. And we also fill in the inbox because we knew some are calling inside. Then move on, we have our chorus frogs. And they go down as a code 3 and that they were inside. No number is given again because we don't know how many are calling. We can't count. So that's the simplistic way of filling out the forms, and you just do it for every station, and you can move on to something else later. Now, some troubleshooting. Some people still like to not tell me about the outside amphibians. Those are important. So when you fill out your forms, always include those amphibians calling outside 100 meters. A lot of people like to include the individuals calling behind them. I'm not so sure if that's so much the case or when they fill out the field forms. It just looks like the calling behind them, and actually they just need to be bumped up and into the wetland itself. So just be careful where you're putting those amphibians on your field forms to make sure that they're within if they are in. And if they're outside behind you, don't include them. And this is a minor point. Some people like to include counts with a code 3. It's not data we can use because it's not complete, but it doesn't cause harm to put it in. It just means more math for you. And there are people who like to provide calling codes without counts for 2 and 1. That is data that's we can't use as well. Or they provide calling counts without codes. That we can't use at all. The other thing that some people do, especially in small wetlands, if there are amphibians calling in the far away, they say, well, these are not within our sampling area, so I'm not going to include them. Well, still include them, because the whole point is that you're recording everything you hear within that you hear. So put those down. And then, again, I just want to reiterate that we need you to be careful with the identification of unusual species in unusual places and at unusual times. If you are certain that you've done your background work and you know your ID and you know what you're supposed to be there and you are certain you are and confident what you're reporting is correct, report it. Absolutely. I may still email you and say, are you sure? But I don't want you not to tell me about unusual things. I just want you to be confident when you do so. And the other thing that a lot of people don't do is they don't include the weather conditions. More common ones, as many of you know who have surveyed for the program for a long time, there's stations that we have to stop surveying for one reason or another. Scientist Doug Toes always tell me is a station, a location is a location is a location. So if you stop surveying A, you just leave A blank. And B, that was B to begin with, is still B and will always be B. You can't flip your station identifiers around as some stations are retired. Another common problem is people try to complete the survey sheet in the field, the summary sheet, instead of bothering the field form. Now, personally, I think that's the same as riding a unicycle and juggling at the same time. It's too much to do and there's a greater risk for error. The other one is they like to use notebooks instead of field forms. I don't recommend that because on the field form, it has all the information you have to tell us on it. Your notebook doesn't. A rare error, but becoming more common as we have people doing all these little wetlands, that they try to put data from two routes on the same summary sheet. That doesn't work when we enter the data. Well, I should be able to catch it and say, oh no, this is a single survey route and it's got 3 stations on it, so something has changed here. It's not always the case. There's no guarantee that I'm the one data checking. We're trying to train other people to do this now. So make a point, if you have 2 separate routes, even though they're single station routes, to put them on separate summary sheets. As for the field forms, as long as you ID which route that station is on, go ahead and use a single field form. I'm okay with that because it isn't scanned in. Some people don't include their field forms when they send it in. I don't know whether they think they're too covered in bug stuff or whether it's just too much weight to mail. We use that for quality control, so please include them. It's amazing how many people don't provide the route identifiers and don't try to drop something, either a name or a user ID or a Marsh name or something consistently on all form. If you're new to the program, you may not have those IDs yet, so you just need to put your name on it. This is exceptionally important if you do multiple routes, and we do have people out there who will do 10, 12, 15 routes. So that's important as well. And the other one is not including the route contact form or changing the stations without telling us and not putting it on the route contact form. Finally, I really want to reiterate how much we appreciate habitat data annually. We're at the point we can do a lot more with it, so please make a point of getting out there and taking the habitat description forms every year. I know it's more difficult. I know you have to go out in the daylight. Some of us don't like the daylight, but try to get that done as well. Now, we really covered most of the big stuff here. Do we have any more questions, Amanda, or any more polls?
Yeah, we have one question. So a good question from Mark. He has a route assigned but does not have any details on exactly where the stations are. How does he get the GPS coordinates?
He waits until I send them to him, and that, I know, is a lesson in patience. I am so sorry about that, Mark. I managed to get all my Southern people their information by Sunday night this weekend, and I'm doing a bit of a triage. Next will be my people in Central Ontario who do amphibian routes or of some sort, amphibian and birds. Anything with amphibians, they'll go out first. And if you just do bird surveys, they will go out later because I have a bit more time to play with, because bird surveys don't start till mid-May. So I have a long list of who needs routes, and now over half of them are done. Actually, three quarters of it done. So yours should be coming out soon.
Perfect. Okay, no more questions for now. So let's keep going.
All right. And we're doing well time-wise, I think. I just wanted to mention returning data. It's another subject that's not your favorite, but we'd like to mention it. There's a lot of paperwork with the Marsh Monitoring Program survey. It's a big, intense survey, and we are asking a lot of you guys, and we appreciate what you're sending in. And I know that sometimes the paperwork can be daunting. And the only thing I can suggest to you is try to make sure you use those MMP forms, the field forms in the field, because it has all the right questions on it. Do not take that data and copy it on a clean sheet to send it to me. I don't need to see clean sheets. They actually make me a little nervous because I wonder if you're taking your field forms out in the field. We understand about coffee stains and bug stains and that mosquitoes leave blood on things and that forms get wrinkled and things like that. That's normal, and it's okay to send me data that looks a little worn out and like it's been in the rain. That's perfectly okay. As I said, the other way to help is to try to do those summary sheets as soon as you can. Don't leave them to the last minute. It's a lot easier. Remember to provide those data, those identifiers for the volunteer on the forms. A point that unfortunately I think is a challenge for people at times is photocopying or scanning the forms prior to returning them. It seems, I know, in some ways silly to do so, but every year there's one or two sets of data that get lost in the mail, and I really am uncomfortable with having to con people up and say, hey, you know, that didn't make it here. Do you have a backup copy? And then every once in a while they say, no, I don't. Usually anymore they say, yes, I do. The other thing is, if we do have a problem and you have a copy in front of you, I can contact you at any time at your convenience, and we can sit there and compare forms, and we can sort out your questions or mine on the forms, and that makes it a lot easier. Try to send the original data forms to us by July 31st. We do have an online data entry system, and some people use it. Right now we're not encouraging it, predominantly because it's a considerable work for you and for us. We hope at some point it's a better system, but we strongly believe right now that it's more efficient for you to send us the data forms, and it's less work for you to send us the data forms and entering it online. What's left? Oh, volunteer safety. This is something I want to bring up and make sure that everybody stays safe out there. Keep in mind, when you're volunteering, is your site still accessible at both day and night? We have had to retire sites because of bad reputations. If you think your site is one of those, feel free to call me and say, this is just not good. I can't survey here. It's not safe. And we will literally note in the system that it's not safe and make sure nobody else goes back into that site. Safety gear is important. Try to carry a cell phone. In most of our marsh monitoring areas, you do have cell phone reception, unlike the owl survey, where you get into a lot of areas without reception. So you want to make sure you have a flashlight. You want bug repellent and tick prevention. A cell phone, somebody suggested a whistle is quite handy if you're out there, if you do get hurt, because then they can find you easier. For road routes, remember that you see others more easily than they see you, so wear bright colors. Keep in mind traffic. If you have to park a little farther away and walk, but that's safer for you in your car, do so. And if you do park in a poor place, I'm quite certain the police will come and tell you to move that car, which makes your survey that much more difficult. Boat routes. We don't have a lot of people in canoes, but if you do a canoe out, watch the weather. Wear a life jacket. Make sure you have lights on your boat, even if it's a canoe. And I think even a canoe nowadays requires to have a bailing bucket of some sort. That may be dependent on province and state, but it's still worth your while to have something in there. And track the weather conditions. I mean, if it's raining, it's okay to be surveying. If it's light rain, amphibians don't like really heavy rain, so don't survey in heavy rain. Certainly don't be out there in storms. Don't be out there if you think the wind's going to suddenly get bad and things like that. Finally, the best thing I think you can do for yourself to have a secure and fun and safe survey is to have somebody with you. So drag your neighbor or your partner or somebody with you just to keep you company, to hold your equipment that you don't want to hold while you're counting things, and just to be there so you're not alone. Some newer concerns that are coming up, some of these are safety, some of these are just more situations that are arising. I've had a lot of questions this year about safety of people going off trail in places with a heavy presence of ash trees. So be careful about going off trail, especially in areas where they have it posted as not safe. Again, we should probably retire or temporarily abandon that site for a few years. Protect yourself from ticks. There's stuff in the letter you received this year about protecting yourself from tick. Make sure you understand the best things to do for your. If your area needs a permit, make sure you're in compliance with that permit. Wear safe and comfortable footwear, especially if you're in a rugged site. If you need information from landowner, ask for it. We're happy to give it to you. And finally, if at any point you don't think it's a good idea going into that site or a good idea to survey that night, just don't. This is a long-term survey, so missing the occasional bit of data is not a big deal. It's more important that everybody stays safe and has a good time. So we have something fun coming up. If people have time to participate, we're going to do a little bit of a marsh monitoring mock point count exercise, and all you need is a scrap piece of paper to do this. Now, it's more fun if we could play the calls, but we can't, so we're going to do this without calls. If you want to make spring peeper calls in your head or say them out loud while you do the mock survey, feel free. So to begin with, we're going to basically say this little area here is your wetland, and we're going to start to do a small survey with it. And to begin with, say you're hearing dozens of spring peepers, and they're calling everywhere. You can't quite figure out where. There's some within the 100 meters and some beyond the 100 meters. And there's so many you cannot possibly count there. So pretending your scrap piece of paper is your semicircle, where on that semicircle would you place your spring peepers? And I'll give a few seconds here to answer that. Are we getting any more questions, Amanda?
Yeah, just a few. How different is it surveying boat versus land? And how do you know if you need a boat route?
Boat versus land? And is it a boat route? Okay, we'll discuss that after we go over the mock. So next, I'm hearing that, but you guys aren't. You're at your station, and the next thing you hear is there's three northern leopard frogs, and they're giving calls, and they're not overlapping, so you can hear each one of them, and they're right in front of you. But also, back in the distance, beyond 100 meters, there's many dozens more, and you can't count how many northern leopard frogs is calling in the distance. So go ahead and record that on your form. And because time is getting a little tight, I think we're already at 7:30, correct? Or 8:30, yes.
Some people are hearing that. So if you
can hear it
even louder, yeah, maybe that's a better recording.
Isn't that funny? I'll have to sort, I will make sure I sort that out before the bird calls. So how do we write this down? So for your spring peepers to begin with, remember there was dozens of them and you couldn't count them and they were in and out of the survey area. So I don't know if you guys can see my cursor or not. So you put spring peeper code 3 within the survey area and spring peeper code 3 outside of the survey area. I find everybody has their own technique for that. As long as I can see that there's spring peepers in both places and it's a code 3, I'm happy. For your northern leopard frogs, you had a code 1 quite close to you and there's 3 calling and there's no overlap, so that's a code 1 with 3 calling. Plus you had a full chorus in the distance, code 3. And then over on your little species in out, you put in and out from both spring peeper and northern leopard frogs because you have species calling inside 100 meters and outside for both groups of individuals. Then you go and fill out the forms. And again, what's your highest calling code for northern leopard frog? Well, it's 3, so you just put down 3. And spring peeper, there's 3. Now, this is a prime example here with your northern leopard frogs. It looks like this northern leopard frog within 100 meters, code 1, 3 individuals calling should be more important, but it isn't. The code 3 is that important, but we need to tell you. You need to tell us about the fact that they were in, and you fill out the little circle box that says it's in when you do it. And that is it for that component. We'll go over that in a minute. So the questions were, is it different surveying boat versus land? It absolutely is. And again, it's different from amphibians and birds as well. There's different issues. I am not inclined to put amphibian surveyors in a canoe on open water unless they can show me confidence in canoeing, because you are out at night and you are in open water, and a lot of our canoe routes are in coastal sites, so you can get into very significant trouble if you're not comfortable and confident with your canoeing. In these situations, I think with a canoe route for amphibians, you definitely have to flag it. You definitely have to have a partner with you, and you probably need a good headlamp or something so you can pick up your flagging or whatever you've done to mark your stations to get you there. I guess a GPS would work as well for that. How do you know if it is a boat route? Usually I have those identified in our system, so I will tell you if it's a canoe route. If you get a map and it obviously shows your stations out in the middle of a wetland and they're away from shoreline, definitely don't assume it's a canoe route. Contact me and say, is it a canoe route? Because there's always a chance that there's been a bit of a conversion error with the station information and we can double check. But yeah, often if you have to swim for a site, it's handy to have a canoe. But we have, most of the canoe routes are on the bigger wetlands, the bigger marshes. So if you're doing an interior marsh or if you're doing one that has a lot of boardwalks and trails, chances are it's a trail-based system. Now, if you are doing bird surveys, it is even more challenging for birds, I think, with a canoe. In some ways, I think you're better off with an actual small boat. The reason being is you have to rely more on hearing when you're doing a bird survey from a canoe than you would if you're doing it from a higher vantage point on land, because you're below a lot of the vegetation. So your sound becomes that much more important. So while I say that you have to identify at least 50 species by sight and sound for bird surveys at a regular site, I would say you have to be able to identify all common species by sound to do it from a canoe. And there's a few other challenges, like go quicker. You're going to have to actually say the words, Amanda. Okay, and we'll get that going as well. Do we have any other questions, Amanda?
Yeah, quick question. What's the new danger with the ash trees?
Well, because of, it's the emerald ash borer has come into Ontario. I don't know if we see it in a lot of the states, and it's causing a lot of deadwood. This started, about 10 years ago, and now the trees are at the point in many of our beautiful conservation areas and woodlots that they're blowdown risk. So there's a, and they've all happened at the same time. So until the they can make sure these locations are safe, as many urban parks and natural areas or and managed areas will, you're at considerable risk for blowdown and liability issues going into these sites. So they want to keep people out of them, and I personally want you to be aware that this may occur. In theory, you're not supposed to be surveying in high winds anyways, but we don't want people to be in a situation where they're getting in trouble with trees.
Okay, and then a really good question. In the photo that's on the screen right now, where would be the farthest point for the survey?
That is a really good question, and it's very difficult to say because, you know, you really can't judge distance in a photo very easily. Now, what I would do to make sure I was surveying the right distance out, I would take where I'm standing at my focal point, and assuming you're on the trail, I would figure out what is 100 meters or 50 meters or 100 meters to my right, and 50 and 100 meters on my left, and then use those to estimate out into the wetland, because we don't want you slogging out there to put flagging tape up. And by having those, even a little bit of flagging tape or some kind of memory of what that 100 meters were on each side, you can estimate out into the wetland. It's a fair distance out there in this picture. I would say well beyond that, you'd be going right through that little open water area back to the cattail vegetation in the back, and further beyond that would be my best guess. But if you can somehow find a way to measure the distance and give yourself a reference point in advance, it will help you a lot.
Great. I don't think there's any more questions right now.
Somebody just said measure your steps and walk it out each direction, then project it out. Yep, that is good. That's Catherine. And then some of the more modern types, they would use a GPS to measure out 100 meters. Or if you're lazy, like some of us, you'd get out the car and then you'd move your, drive the car 100 meters and check the odometer. So there's many ways of doing it. Or if you are a hunter or a gun enthusiast, you may have a rangefinder and you can actually figure out that distance. So there's a lot of options out there that you can use for these things. Now, what I have left is not that important. We've got the main bits covered. I wanted to just go over one, resources. I will be unfortunately away from the office for the last week of April into the beginning of May, so I wanted to make sure that everybody knew where the online resources was. And that, if you check your newsletter, it says birdscanada.org, birdmon/MMP, and that's a secure website. And if you go there and you set up a login and I approve it in advance, you can pull off your MP3 files, you can pull off protocols, forms, all that stuff is available there for you to get. So there is options out there for materials when I'm not at my desk, or like right now I'm difficult to get a hold of, which I am at the moment. Finally, I need to make a point of, well, here's the page and you can register at the bottom to create a new login for this site. I think we got all the questions covered now, right, Amanda?
One more. Does a full moon change anything?
Does a what change anything?
A full moon.
Well, it makes it easier to see where you're stepping, which is lovely. Does it change anything? I don't know. It makes you more obvious to the amphibians, but mind you, they're probably hearing you anyways. I think it's safer for you to be out there. My thought is they love dreary nights, so they're going to like the cloudier night and the very moist night better. For a lot of species, bullfrogs, I think, are an exception, because I love those really warm, hot, moist nights that happen in the end of June, beginning of July. Nothing I've ever read has said that it makes a difference to have a full moon for the frogs. For you, it might. It might make it a little easier to survey. Are we, anything else?
No, not for now.
I just wanted to mention, if you ever have... Do you want to mention anything about the important bird area, Amanda, since I dragged you? Nope, So if you ever want to learn about the important bird area, check out our website, because that's Amanda's program. And to be fair to her, she was nice enough to help me out today, so I should mention that.
Thanks for having me.
And that's it. I want to reiterate that you are the people that make this program work. Without the volunteers, it just would not be successful. So we really appreciate your involvement in this. And this is not all our partners, but it really gives you an idea how many partners we have in the program and how important those partnerships are as well. We can go on if people are interested, and we can do a bit of the vegetation habitat description stuff. We are sitting at what time now? We have been here quite a while, and some of you guys came on really early. Do you, if I'm thinking we should probably stop. Is there any people out there who really want to hear the habitat work, or should we hold it off for another day? And we'll go with that. Jan, you want to hear about the habitat descriptions? All right, well then we'll just keep going a little bit. We can probably do it in 10 minutes and we'll go from there. And if people want to leave, thank you for joining us and have a great evening, and I hope your first amphibian surveys go very well. So why do we survey habitat? Myself, I'm a habitat person. I love habitat, but a lot of people find it a complicated thing to do. The point of the habitat is to get an idea of which vegetation characteristics and wetland conditions are important to amphibians. It's not so much looking at specific species, but more like type of species. The habitat descriptions should not take very long, a couple minutes per station. So they don't have to be fancy. They don't have to be technically difficult or well drawn or anything like that. They'll all be better than what I would draw. I can promise you that. They are best done between late May and mid-June. We're saying for the frog surveyors about the time of the second visit, for bird surveyors about the time of the first visit. Now, a lot of people think, well, why can't I leave it till the very end and do it when I'm taking down my flagging tape? And in some ways that makes sense, but unless you're 6 feet tall, you won't see up with the vegetation. So for us vertically challenged people, you want to do it earlier when you have enough vegetation growing up that you can see things, but not so much that you can't see. And what you do is you stand at your focal point and you estimate the coverage around you. So here's your classic habitat form, and it's a simple multiple choice form. I don't think I show it here. Let's see if I do. No, I don't. There's a lot of definitions on here. Now, unless you print this off online on the opposite side of the page, you'll have all the definitions for all the codes on this. So once again, we don't leave you without the information you need in the field. It's all there. Like we talk about open water being at least water that's deep enough to float a canoe in and at least the size of a piece of plywood. We have definitions that are easy to work with that. And so when you're doing this, the first thing we look at the major habitats that you found in your area. So I like to draw the vegetation picture very quickly as soon as I get there because it centers me in. Some people like Doug and other people, they feel they don't have to draw that. They can just answer the questions without seeing it. But by drawing my little picture first, it gives me an idea what I'm looking at and I have a better judgment call. So what I do when I walk in is I look at the 100 meter radius and I see what's out there and I give a quick sketch, just like the one here, and that's as complicated as it needs to get. And I use that to base all my answers on. So the first question is, how much percent of that whole 100 meter area, radius semicircle area, is emergent vegetation? Well, emergent vegetation is anything, basically, really simplified, it's non-woody, so it's not shrubs and trees, and it's standing out of the water. And here I'm saying I think 80% of it is. How much of it is open water? And I feel there's about 15% of that whole area is open water. Trees and shrubs, how much? I'm estimating there's no trees, which was one dead tree, so I decided it didn't count. There's about 5% shrubs. So how much open water and floating plant cover that we can see? Again, if you do go too early, there won't be any floating plant cover. But in this particular wetland, I found it was slight. wetland permanency. Now that's something you often know from your site, and you'll learn through time whether it's dry or not. Maybe the first few times you have to look at a map to find this. Is it permanent, is it semi-permanent, or seasonal? So that's something you can figure out as you go. Wetland size, we have definitions on the back, and you would base that on the overall size of the wetland. It's an estimate, remember. We're not asking you to give us the acreage. We're just asking for an estimate of what the size is. What's behind you? Is it marsh? Is it field? Choose whatever is the most obvious. Human influence is affecting the sample air. Well, we all know there'll be a lot of those. So pick the two or three or four that are most obvious and mark that down. And there, your left-hand side is full. Now, people have a lot of problems with number G, the dominant emergent vegetation. The reason being is they think these numbers on this side have to tie into this 80%. They do not. When you move over to the dominant emergent vegetation, you look at that wetland area again, and you ignore everything but the vegetation and the emergent vegetation. You ignore your trees, you ignore your shrubs, and you just look at your emergent vegetation, and you say, okay, what are the four most common species that I see? And you list them. Okay, there are these four. Cacti, grasses and sedges, rushes, bulrushes, and pickleweed. Okay, what percentage of all the vegetation, not all the cover, but of all the vegetation is the cacti? Well, I think about half of all the vegetation that is emergent is cacti, 50%. Grasses and grass-like sedges, I think, is 20%. Rushes, bulrushes, 10, pickleweed, 10. You don't have to go below 10%, so this may never add up to 100. It should not add up to the amount of vegetation in A either. So you could have, for example, 100% cacti. You could have a total, as in this case, when we got 90%, because there's a whole bunch of little stuff out there. All those non-dominant ones we don't track. It's just the four most dominant ones. And that's it. You're done. You can move on to the next station. Now, I know there was some questions on this. What were they, Amanda?
There's just one. So one of my sites has two areas of open water. Later in the season, one of them is often completely covered with duckweed and the other one is not. How should we handle this?
This is a single station. It's a single station. You base it as one sampling area. So if it's got a lot of open water and half that open water is covered in duckweed, you have about 50% coverage. I don't have the actual definitions in front of me, but I'm pretty sure that would be heading towards dense. But just look at moderate and dense and see which ones fit the best for that particular wetland. It's not perfect.
I think maybe she's asking, like, when should she record the habitat? Because at one point in the season, it would be a different density than the other points in the season.
Oh, you absolutely, it will be. That's why we try to pick it all around that mid-May date, just because if we're all consistent about it, it will give us a better idea what's out there, and we're all on the same page. It's never going to be perfect, and some years you'll have more than other years. And that also happens, and that's why we ask for it every year. And that's the best I can suggest. Just do your best with that. Try to time it for that mid-May date and go from there. Now, somebody also asked about the May date, May timing. What was that question, Amanda?
I think I find visits two seems too early, maybe. I don't see enough growth. Maybe it's because she looks from a trail or higher up.
Is she further north? Like, who's the person?
Catherine.
You could be in a situation where you're far enough north that it's not growing yet, or a deeper wetland. And that's fair. If you think you need to wait a little bit longer and you can afford to do that, go ahead. Just be careful not to wait too long. You want your vegetation sprouted up, but you don't want it fully grown. So you want to be able to see which species are there, but you don't want to have a lot of height to it. Now, I think somebody mentioned that the one about the double stations and the density of the duckweed was based on these two separate cells that she surveys at the same time. Just do your best guess. If you feel it's dense because it's all covering the one cell, put it down as dense. That's a difficult one to broach. I will admit to that. But I think that's the way I would probably handle it. Okay.
Great. Any other questions, everyone?
All right. So we are sitting at 9 o'clock and supposedly this is going to end at 9. And so while I would love to talk about research, I think we're going to hold that off to another day. We'll end the talk and I'm so glad you all attended. Amanda, do we have anything else we need to cover?
I think that was all.
All right. Well, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop recording and end the session. We did not figure out how to put a poll up for you guys for an end webinar, so I'm apologizing for that. And best of luck with your surveys. And don't hesitate to email me if you have any questions. Bye for now.
Bye.